copyrighted program created by Rio Grande.
Columbia County Sheriff's Office calling all cars, attention all cars, broadcast 263 at the Bedford Barn in Yanktown. Investigate the trouble. That's all. Frederick Lindsay speaking. Once every week for 5 years, I've been speaking to you on this program. For 5 years, we've been ready through the magic of your radio to bring into your home a thrilling half hour of entertainment. For 30 minutes, we shut the world away and live imaginatively in the realm of human drama, a treat that costs the giver many thousands of dollars. Now, if we furnish you with acceptable entertainment, and if we contribute to your enjoyment, don't you believe it fair and reasonable that we ask you to put our product to one fair test? Here is the basis of sound buyer-seller relationships. Reciprocity, mutual confidence, fair exchange, efficient service, and excellence of product. All of this we promise. All of this we guarantee. Will you do your part? Make one stop at a Rio Grande station tomorrow. The size of your purchase is of no consideration in this test. We merely want to show our son that this appeal to you will be answered, and that your appreciation does justify another year of 52 calling all cars programs. The cast, the sponsors, and I thank with sincere appreciation those of you who during the last 2 weeks have already graciously responded to our request. And to our friends who haven't yet returned our many visits to your home, may we expect to see you at your Rio Grande dealers tomorrow. The story we have to hear tonight has been taken from the confidential files of the office of the Sheriff of Columbia County, Oregon. We have therefore asked Sheriff M. R. Calhoun to open our program from San Francisco.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It is with pleasure that I avail myself of the opportunity tonight to join the law enforcement officers who have spoken to you on this program. The life of a peace officer is not an easy one. And we welcome anything that will help us bring home to the public the unprofitable nature of crime. There is a question in my mind whether the thought that crime does not pay would have deterred the criminal about whom we shall hear tonight. But on the whole, the more we stress the losing aspect of crime, the more we do toward the control and eventual elimination of the criminal element. I am glad to be able to add material from my files to the already vast evidence that crime does not pay.
Hello, girls.
Hello, Mother. Mother.
How did the bean picking go today? Was the sun hot?
Oh, yes, it was hot, Mother.
How are you, Ruthie? I'd have come over and got you at noon, only your father had the car. You're too young a child to be working all day in that hot sun.
Oh, I'm all right, Mother. I'm awful thirsty, though. I'm going to get a drink.
No, let me get it for you. Both of you sit down and rest. I know you must be tired.
Yes, I'm awful tired. I'm tired, too.
Just a minute till I put some ice in it for you, girls.
It's still my head. Oh, it's
well,
hot.
Here we are.
My
goodness, what's that you have all over your face?
Oh, we stopped up the road and ate some blackberries.
Oh. Oh, yeah, I noticed you eating them the other day. Do you eat them every day?
Uh-huh. I bet we ate almost a bushel today. I sure was thirsty. That water tasted good.
Yeah, I thought it would be. That long walk and those blackberries was bound to make you thirsty.
Oh, I feel swell now. Thanks a lot, Mother.
Now, I want you girls to go lie down for a little while till your father gets home. Try and get a nap, Lucy.
All right, I'll try, Mother.
Thank you. so glad you're home. I've sent for Dr. Ross. The girls are terribly sick.
Sick? Well, they were all right this morning. What's the matter with them?
I don't know. Oh, why doesn't that doctor get here?
Susie, what's all this about?
Oh, Daddy, I'm terribly sick.
Where do you feel worse?
My stomach. It feels like there's a knife in it.
It hurts here?
Oh, please don't touch it. It feels like... I just can't stand it.
Where's Dorothy?
She's in the next room. I wouldn't disturb her. She ain't as sick as Ruth.
When did they get sick, Agnes?
Well, about half an hour ago. It was so sudden, I got frightened and called the doctor right away. I can't understand it.
Neither can I. What have they been eating?
Well, they ate some blackberries on the way home from bean picking.
Blackberries wouldn't make them this sick. What did you eat for lunch, Ruth?
I don't know. I can't think of anything but this awful pain.
Well, the doctor will be here in a minute.
Tell him to hurry. Please tell him to hurry.
I think that thing's coming now. Yeah, it is.
Hello, George.
Hello, Dr. Ross.
What seems to be the trouble?
Well, the girls were taken sick about half an hour ago. They ate a lot of blackberries.
Blackberries? Well, that doesn't sound serious. You get to be a pretty big girl and have stomach trouble, Ruthie.
Please do something for me, Doctor. My stomach, it hurts so terribly.
Yeah, that'll never do. I have to find out what the trouble is in a hurry. Just hold this thermometer in your mouth for a second or two.
We'll be in the next room with Dorothy, Doctor.
I'll be in a few minutes.
I think she's asleep. She's awful pale, though.
Are you asleep, Dorothy?
No, Daddy, but there's blinding light in front of my eyes.
Is your stomach hurt?
It feels like I'm tying the knot. I can hardly breathe. It hurts.
Can you remember what you and Ruth ate for lunch?
Just some fresh vegetables and milk.
The blackberries you ate coming home. Were they racked?
Yes. Oh, that wasn't it, Daddy. I've been sick at my stomach before, but this is different. I never felt anything like this before, Daddy. I think I'm dying.
Dorothy, how can you say such a thing? Well, it's nothing but acute gastritis, that's what it is. It's painful, but it's not at all serious.
What makes you think it's acute gastritis?
Well, because I know it is. They have all the symptoms of it.
Yes, Dorothy.
Daddy, Ruth is suffering when I am with you.
She's pretty sick, but don't worry. You'll be all right tomorrow, darling.
No.
This is just one of those things you have to go through.
Daddy, the way I feel, I don't care whether I live or not.
Oh, my
God. She's delirious. I'm going to call the doctor.
Daddy, you don't think I'm delirious, do you?
No, darling. I know what you mean. And you've got to get well. I wouldn't have anything to live for it.
Don't worry about it, there, Doctor.
Well, I think these youngsters have a touch of stomach complaints and hot sun, eating all those blackberries, and then the ice water. You shouldn't have given ice water to them on a hot day like this, Mrs. Edwards.
Oh, I'm sorry, Doctor. I didn't realize it had hurt them.
Oh, of course not. Well, then just take Dorothy's pulse. George, I thought you said Dorothy wasn't as ill as Ruth.
Agnes said she wasn't.
Well, she was quieter. She didn't seem to be.
Dorothy's a very sick girl. I can't understand it.
Oh, George, I'm afraid Dorothy is going to die. You used to be a preacher. Say a prayer for her.
Yes. Yes, of course. Dr. Ross, will she?
I'm a man of medicine, George. There's nothing else I can do.
Oh, Lord, my gracious Father in heaven, surely it cannot be thy divine will that this child should be taken from us. Thou hast said that only as a child shall we enter the kingdom of heaven. But thou knowest my need of companionship and solace.
Hear us, Lord.
Thy gracious mercy. Thou canst spare these lives to us.
Amen.
Hear the plea of thy servant who begs on bended knee.
Thy will be done.
I'm weak, O Lord. But do not visit my sins upon my daughter. Tell them to me.
In that strange, stirring ritual, Dorothy Bedford fell off to sleep with the throbbing of their groaning voices in her ears. The girl did not die, but in the following week, Dr. Ross was confronted with the most formidable puzzle of his professional career. The Bedford girls became human barometers, suffering acutely one day and gaining ground the next, until the physician was completely baffled. And then on Saturday, September 4th...
Well, here we are, Irene.
Well, you're just in time, Mr. Bedford. Dinner's all ready.
Where's Mrs. Bedford?
Agnes is bringing some more groceries from the car.
Oh.
The girls all right?
Yes, they seem to get better every minute. Oh, my, but it does a body good to see them sitting up again. Even in bed.
Yes, it really does.
Hello, Irene. How are the girls?
Oh, just fine, Mrs. Bedford. I just gave them their dinner. I wasn't sure when you'd get home.
Well, I got them some soda pop.
Oh, Ruthie's so fond of it. Now, that was real nice. Now, you two just go in and sit down, and I'll put dinner on the table. You can talk to the girls afterwards.
It was nice of you to stay with the girls when we went to town, Irene.
Land sakes, I was glad to do what I could. It was little enough.
It certainly was a relief to get out in the sunshine.
Well, I should think so. To sitting up day and night with those children for a week. Why, it's a wonder you weren't in bed.
This is truly a Thanksgiving dinner, Agnes.
Mm, yes. Thanksgiving Day won't compare with this.
There. Well, it's not what I'd call a fancy dinner, but, well, I don't think it'll poison anybody.
Here's the dinner, please. Our Father, as we partake of this food, thou knowest our hearts are overflowing with gratitude for thy mercy in restoring the health of our beloved children. To thee we give all praise and thanks. Amen.
George.
Yes, Aggie?
I think I'll take the soda pop into the girls now. They'll enjoy it with their dinner.
All right. Tell them I'll be in a few minutes.
The ways of the Almighty are sometimes very mysterious, Irene.
Goodness, yes. But I guess it's just to try our faith.
Our faith, yes. But why should innocent children suffer?
No, I don't know. I just don't. I guess nobody ever did explain that.
Nope. Well. I'm just a simple-minded farmer who never should have tried to be an evangelist.
I wonder what's taking Agnes so long.
Agnes! Agnes, hurry up! Your dinner's getting cold.
I'll be right with you. Go ahead and eat. I'll be right back.
Hello, Mother.
Hello, Ruthie. Look what I brought you from town.
Oh, goody. Soda pop. This is a treat.
Yes, I thought you'd like it.
I guess I must be all well now if I can drink this.
Oh, yes, you'll be up and around in a few days.
Mother, you've been so nice and so kind to me since I've been sick.
Well, I've only done what any real mother would.
Mother, can Dorothy sleep with me tonight? I want to talk to her.
Well, certainly she can, Lucy. I'll bring her in right now. And then I want you to try to go to sleep. You're still not very strong.
All right, I'll try, Mother.
Oh, Danny.
Oh, my Sammy.
Where are you?
Oh, Dorothy, hold me.
Somebody do something for us.
Dorothy, I'm dying. I'm dying, Dorothy.
Operator, get me Dr. Ross and send me an ambulance. I don't know the number. Hurry. My girls are dying. Hurry.
George, I think you and your wife better come in.
Oh.
Doctor's here in the hospital, and I work frantically, but we don't know what it is.
Doctor, how is Ruth?
I'm afraid Ruth is beyond human help.
Oh, no, no.
Quiet, quiet. Her suffering is over.
Ruth. My daughter.
Dr. Ross, please come out in the corridor. Doctor, I gotta be brave so we can save Dorothy. If you knew what killed Ruth, do you think you could save Dorothy's life?
Possibly, yes.
Then I want an autopsy on Ruth as soon as it can be done.
An autopsy?
Yeah. There's something wrong about all this. Something terribly wrong.
I think you're right, Mrs. Bedford. Absolutely right, and I'll order an autopsy at once.
Agnes Bedford's hope was a vain one. Dorothy died in sickening torture a few hours later, and then came a chemical analysis report that reverberated across the county like thunder. Dr. Frank Minnie of the Oregon Medical School stated that Ruth and Dorothy Bedford died of arsenical poisoning. The report sent Sheriff Millard Calhoun and Captain Clyde Warren of the state police rushing to the Bedford farm.
Yes, I know it's shocking news, Mrs. Bedford, but it's got to be faced.
So it was arsenic poisoning.
Certainly was.
Well, that sort of confirms an idea I didn't want to mention before. It might have sounded foolish.
What idea was that?
Well, the blackberry patch. You see, the first time the girls showed any sign of illness, they'd eaten a lot of blackberries from some bushes down the road on Clyde Watson's place. From what I know now, they had all the symptoms of arsenic poisoning. Fever, nausea, and thirst.
I don't see the connection, Miss Bedford.
I'm getting to that. Just the day before, Clyde had been spraying his potato patch right next to the berries with arsenic solution. I saw the white clouds rolling over the field from the sprayer. I tell you, Sheriff, those blackberries were poisoned.
What do you know about that? Well, we're much obliged, Miss Bedford. We'll take a look at that patch right now. It may give us the answer to this.
Yeah. Won't take me long to find out if that's where they got poisoned.
We'll let you know what we find, Miss Bedford.
Oh, thank you, Sheriff.
Well, there's the field. Let's cut across the yard.
All right.
Well, Warren, what do you think?
I don't know what I do think. But I know what I don't. I don't think you could get enough arsenic on blackberries from another field to kill anybody.
I'll admit it doesn't sound logical.
Yeah. Plenty of things happen in our business that no reasoning can explain.
Yeah. Well, here's the bushes. We'll take some berries and have them analyzed. Some of those potato vines from the next field.
Yeah, those berries sure look good. They make me hungry.
You better save your hunger until we get to town.
Oh, no. I can't wait that long. And I don't feel like waiting that long for a test tube to tell us they're not poisoned. Well, here goes the evidence.
Hey, don't eat those berries.
Too late now. You got a human test tube.
That took a lot of nerve. What do we do now? That is, after you leave the doctor's office.
I'm not going to a doctor. Tomorrow, when I'm still very much alive, we'll start working on this case.
Okay, Warren. That's the way it is. You see what you can pick up from the neighbors. If the family had any enemies or if there was any discontent in the home and that sort of thing. I'll contact the out-of-town people, Bedford's former wife and her relatives.
Yeah. And then?
Then we'll start canvassing the drugstores to see who bought poison recently.
Yeah, maybe we ought to do that first.
No, that's a long, hard job. Anybody that bought poison for this wouldn't give their right name. And they certainly wouldn't get it where they're known.
Yeah, that's right.
Besides, arsenic is indestructible. It never disappears. And neither does the record of its sale. So you didn't get much out of Bedford's neighbors, huh?
No, not much. It's a small farm settlement, and they all know each other too well. The impression I got was that Agnes Bedford wasn't very well liked, but her husband was so well thought of, nobody wanted to say anything against her.
That doesn't mean much.
Oh, I did find out that the two girls ran away from home once.
They did?
Yeah.
Did you question the Bedfords about that?
No. It's a pretty touchy subject. I thought I'd find out what you had first.
Well, I covered a lot of drugstores in Columbia County. Didn't get a thing. But as long as we're here, we'll stop in at the local store and glance over the poison register.
What about Bedford's first wife?
No, nothing there. Her brother acted kind of funny, though.
Who's he?
His name's Floyd Grayton. He raved around about the police not having the murderer in jail by this time. Said he was going to the town where Agnes Bedford had lived with her first husband 10 years ago.
So what?
Well, he said when he came back he might have something to tell me. If I don't hear from him in a few days, I'll look up that angle. Well, here's the drugstore. You know, it's too close to the settlement to give us anything.
Come on. Morning, Sheriff. What can I do for you?
Howdy. We'd like to look at your poison register.
Sure, yeah. Come on back, Fred. Yeah.
All right.
What are you looking for?
Just a little sale of arsenic.
Oh, sell lots of it. Farmers use it for bugs and varmints.
You don't happen to remember anybody from around Yanktown buying any recently, do you?
Sure. Mrs. Bedford bought some.
Huh?
She did.
Yeah, she did. Wait a minute. Here it is. Bought on September 4th. Signed, Agnes June Bedford. I told her it was mighty dangerous stuff to have around food or children.
September 4th? That was after the children were taken sick.
Yeah, that was the day they died.
At least you didn't try to conceal the purchase. Come on, Warren, we've got some questions to ask Mrs. Bedford. Bedford, we'd like to look around your house, if you don't mind. We're certain the children were poisoned by something stronger than tainted berries. And it must have come from here.
Why, certainly, Sheriff. Go right ahead and look.
Oh, by the way, you bought some arsenic shortly before the girls died, didn't you?
That's right. I still have the box. I'll show you where I keep it. But the children didn't even know I had it, and
They were in bed all the time.
Where did you keep it?
In the cellar. Come on, I'll show you.
All right.
It's been down here all the time. I never had a chance to use any of it in the garden. Here it is, up on this shelf.
Well, now let's see. Well, the box is open and there's quite a bit missing. You said you didn't use any of it.
No, it fell off the shelf accidentally when I reached for something else when the lid came off. Some of the powder spilled out, so I swept it up and poured it down a drain outside the house.
Yeah, that was the right thing to do. If you don't mind, Miss Bedford, we'll just take this box along with it.
Well, thank you, sir. I'm more than willing to do anything I can to help you.
Thank you. I'm glad to know we can depend on that.
A few days later, Floyd Grayton, uncle of the two girls, waited to see Sheriff Calhoun.
Oh, Sheriff, the uncle of the girls is here. He says he's got something to tell you that may help you solve this case.
Okay, let's talk to him.
All right.
Will you come in here, Mr. Grayton?
All right, sir.
This is Sheriff Calhoun.
Howdy, Mr. Grayton. I hear you've got some information about this Bedford case for us.
Well, I think so, Sheriff Calhoun. It's more about Agnes Bedford than it is the girls, though.
What do you mean?
Well, you see, this happened several years ago up in Brownsville. Agnes was married at the time to a fellow named Matson. Now, one night, Matson took sick just about the same.
Can't you do something for me? It's killing me. I can't breathe.
I've sent for the doctor. What else can I do?
Oh, why don't he get here?
How do I know? He should be getting here now.
What? I can't stand it.
I told you not to eat them oysters.
Oh, that's a fine way for you to talk. You fix them for me.
You didn't have to eat them.
What time is it?
What do you care? You ain't going nowhere.
Oh.
Come in, doctor.
Come as soon as I can get here.
He's over there on the bed. Well, doctor?
Miss Matson, your husband's dead.
I know it.
You know it?
Yeah. I had a premonition.
Well, sir, they buried John Matson a few days after that. And that death certificate read acute gastritis.
Acute gastritis, huh?
Yep.
Are you thinking of the same thing I am?
I'm afraid I am. Operator, get me District Attorney Weatherford on the phone.
What are you going to do?
I'm going to get Linn County officers to dig up John Matson's body. And if I find out what I think I will, I'll ask for a murder complaint against somebody.
To Linn County went Sheriff Calhoun, hunting the trail of a 10-year-old mystery.
Mr. Weatherford will see you now, Sheriff.
Thanks, miss.
Come in, Miller. Want to see me?
Yep, got something on my mind, J.K.
All right, I'll do what I can to help you. What's up?
As district attorney, you've handled practically every case that's come up in this county for some time, haven't you?
That's right.
You remember old man John Matson?
Let me see. He died about 10 years ago, didn't he?
Just 10 years ago, under suspicious circumstances.
I don't remember any investigation of his death.
There wasn't one. That's what I want to get you to do now. Now, let's get to work and get a chemical report on Matson. I've got a hunch he didn't die of acute gastritis.
All right. It'll take a little time.
That's all right. I've got lots of it.
10 years is a long time. Think you'll find anything?
Mm-hmm. Unless I miss my guess, we're going to find a whole mess of arsenic.
Well, Calhoun, I'm afraid you were right about Matson.
That's so? What'd you find out?
There's the chemical report.
You see it. Just as I thought.
How'd you happen to suspect arsenic in this case?
Well, in the first place, Matson died in September.
So what? Lots of people die in September.
Right. But he was supposed to have been poisoned by eating oysters. Oysters are safe in September.
Got an R in it, eh?
Yeah. Besides, the drugstore at Brownsville burned on the night John Matson died.
You don't think it was just coincidence?
No, I don't. I think it was arson to destroy records.
That might be a little hard to prove after 10 years.
That's right, too. But it won't be hard to prove that John Matson died of arsenical poisoning.
And that his wife was the only person who profited by his death.
Right again.
In which case, maybe we'd better issue a murder complaint against her, eh?
I think so. Meantime, I've got one of my own that I think I'll use.
Thus, 10 years after he had died, John Matson was brought back to testify against his widow, for chemical tests showed that arsenic did indeed remain as a damning testimony. John Matson was found to have died of acute arsenical poisoning. Then the glib tongue Jezebel, Agnes Bedford, was arrested.
I want to know the meaning of this, Sheriff.
I think it's pretty clear, even to you, Miss Bedford.
What are you arresting me for?
Murder.
Oh, that's ridiculous.
Perhaps. Where'd you get the arsenic you poisoned your first husband with?
I didn't poison him.
Well, it was fortunate for you that the drugstore at Brownsville burned 10 years ago and all the records with it.
You can't prove anything on me.
Maybe not. Just the same, John Matson was poisoned by someone, and you were the only one who could have done it.
Is that all you're charging me with?
Nope.
What else?
We're charging you with the murder of Ruth and Dorothy Bedford, your stepdaughters.
For heaven's sake, why should I want to murder them?
These insurance policies for $2,000 and all might have been sufficient motive.
You're being funny.
Coupled with the fact that you and your stepdaughters never got along, that their father took their part against you. Murder's been committed for less.
And what did I kill him with, if you're so smart?
Arsenic.
Oh, do you think I'd have signed a book in the drugstore when I bought that arsenic if I'd meant to use it to kill the girls?
You can't tell what a woman will do who's already committed one murder.
You can't keep on accusing me of that.
Besides, take a look at these pictures.
Yeah, what are they?
Those are enlargements of microphotographs of that box of arsenic you told us fell off the shelf in your cellar.
I told you the truth.
Not quite. You see, these pictures show no signs of the box ever having struck the floor. It would have been dented in someplace. But this box has never been dropped from any appreciable height.
You can't scare me.
I'm not trying to.
I told you that box broke open when it fell off the shelf, and I'll...
Stick to it. Yeah, I know. Never mind all that. Take a look at these pictures here. They're microphotographs, too. They show where a knife has been used to cut the top off this box.
You can't prove it.
I believe you mentioned that before. But I think I can. The chemist report shows that the girls got a large dose of arsenic just a few hours before they died. That was after that box had been opened. Besides all that, you asked Dr. Ross to sign these insurance policies before the girls died.
That doesn't prove anything.
Except that you knew they were going to die. That's the reason you demanded the autopsy. Because he refused to sign the death certificate.
We needed the money for the hospital expenses.
You had a more important reason than that. You wanted proof that the girls had been poisoned. You wanted medical proof.
Why should I want that?
Because, according to the records on these policies, you signed them before the girls died. And you gave, as the cause of the death, that which only you knew was correct.
I said acute gastritis.
Maybe that's what you meant to say. But take a look. You made a mistake. You told the truth. You wrote arsenic.
In just a moment, we shall hear concluding facts regarding our program. But before closing our story, remember your friendly gesture to the cast, the sponsor, and me tomorrow. Tell your Rio Grande dealer that you enjoy calling all cars. Here is a Christmas gesture that I hope will bring you personal satisfaction and make us of calling all cars very happy. Agnes Bedford was brought to trial on March 10th of this year. 2 months later, she was sentenced to spend the rest of her life in prison in payment for a crime that did not pay.
County Sheriff's Office calling all cars, attention all cars to cancellation of broadcast 263 regarding a murder. Suspect in this case is now in custody. That's all. Rolling.
Narrator Frederick Lindsley, bidding you good night for Rio Grande.
Next week at this time, Rio Grande will present December Rhapsody. This is the Columbia Broadcasting.